Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Jill Robbins and John Russell. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's technology report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, Jill Robbins has this report on Independence Day in the United States.
The United States celebrates its Independence Day on July 4th. John Adams, who later became America's second president, wrote to his wife in 1776 that the day would be remembered with fireworks and celebrations from one end of this continent to the other. But the day he was talking about was July 2nd, 1776, not July 4th. July 2nd is the day the Continental Congress of the original 13 colonies voted for independence from Britain. Congress did not officially sign the Declaration of Independence, mainly written by Thomas Jefferson, until 2 days later. Pauline Meyer was a historian who wrote the 1997 book, American Scripture, Making the Declaration of Independence. She wrote that in early July of 1777, members of the Continental Congress nearly forgot that it had been a year since they declared their freedom from the British. They remembered on July 3rd. It was too late to celebrate on July 2nd, so they decided to mark the country's independence with a celebration the following day, July 4th. The Pennsylvania Evening Post of Philadelphia reported, "Yesterday, the 4th of July, being the anniversary of the independence of the United States of America, was celebrated in this city with demonstrations of joy and festivity. At night," the Post said, "there was a grand exhibition of fireworks, and the city was beautifully illuminated." The tradition of celebrating Independence Day started to expand after the War of 1812 against Britain. Such celebrations were mostly held on July 4th. John Adams, however, still believed that Americans should celebrate their independence on July 2nd. Historians say Adams reportedly turned down invitations to take part in July 4th events until the day he died. Adams died on July 4th, 1826. That same day, Thomas Jefferson also died. The two men and former presidents were friends as well as rivals. They both died on the 50th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. In 1870, the U.S. Congress made July 4th an official holiday. In July 1776, the U.S. was a country of 2.5 million people. It is now a country of 336 million, the U.S. Census reports. These days, Americans celebrate Independence Day with fireworks and other festivities. In Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, organizers are holding a 16-day festival of fireworks, music, and food to celebrate America's birthday in America's birthplace. But the biggest 4th of July fireworks show is in New York City. It can be seen in the neighboring states of New Jersey and Connecticut. It is also broadcast nationwide on television. The small village of Lewes, Delaware, celebrates the holiday and its coastal history with the Independence Day boat parade. In Los Angeles, California, movie lovers can choose to celebrate the holiday by watching old Hollywood films from the grassy area of the historic Hollywood Forever Cemetery. And far north in Anchorage, Alaska, Independence Day traditions include food, games, and late-night fireworks. With 19 hours of daylight this time of year, the fireworks show does not start until midnight. I'm Jill Robbins.
Weather experts say the storm Hurricane Beryl might represent the beginning of a very active and dangerous hurricane season. It's the earliest Category 5 hurricane on record in the Atlantic, Caribbean, and Central American basin, a World Meteorological Organization, or WMO, spokesperson said. Of Beryl. A Category 5 hurricane brings winds of 252 kilometers an hour or higher. Such storms can cause huge damage, including destruction of homes, roads, and bridges. The WMO spokesperson noted that destructive power, saying it only takes one landfalling hurricane to set back decades of development. Beryl is on an unusually southern path, especially for a major hurricane, said Kristen Corbacero of the University at Albany. Colorado State University hurricane researcher Phil Klotzbach said Beryl is possibly a sign of more interesting stuff that could happen in the near future. He added that there could be several of these kinds of storms coming down later. The water temperature around Beryl is about 1 to 2 degrees Celsius above normal at 29 degrees Celsius, which is great if you are a hurricane, Klotzbach said. Warm water acts as fuel for the thunderstorms and clouds that form hurricanes. The warmer the water and the air at the bottom of the storm, the better the chance it will rise higher in the atmosphere and create larger thunderstorms, said Corbacero. It is not just hot water at the surface that matters. The ocean heat content, which measures deeper water, is far above record levels for this time of year. The levels are currently at what the highest September levels should be, University of Miami researcher Brian McNulty said. This year, there is also a big difference between water temperature and upper air temperature throughout the tropics. The greater that difference is, the more likely it becomes that storms will form and get bigger, said MIT hurricane expert Kerry Emanuel. The Atlantic relative to the rest of the tropics is as warm as I've seen, he said. Atlantic waters have been unusually hot since March 2023, and record warm since April 2023. Klotzbach said a high-pressure system that normally sets up cooling trade winds collapsed then and has not returned. Corbacero said scientists are debating what exactly climate change does to hurricanes. But she said scientists have come to an agreement that climate change makes hurricanes more likely to become strong quickly, as Beryl did, and increases the strongest storms. Emmanuel said the slowing of Atlantic Ocean currents, likely caused by climate change, may also be a factor in the warm water. La Niña, which is a slight cooling of the Pacific that changes weather worldwide, also may be a factor. Experts say La Niña tends to reduce high-altitude winds that weaken hurricanes.
La Niña also usually means more hurricanes in the Atlantic and fewer in the Pacific. The eastern Pacific had zero storms in May and June, something that has only happened twice before, Klotzbach said. Globally, this may be a below-average year for tropical cyclones, except in the Atlantic. I'm John Russell.
Artificial intelligence, AI, tools continue to expand in the workplace, and some U.S. states have launched specialized programs to train workers on how to deal with the new technologies. Many industries are expected to heavily depend on a series of tools known as generative AI. This technology includes systems designed to perform many jobs currently done by humans. Such systems have become increasingly smarter in recent years. In Connecticut, officials have been working to create what they hope will be the country's first Citizens AI Academy. This will be a free online collection of special classes designed to teach basic AI skills and provide certifications needed for employment. Connecticut Democratic Senator James Maroney told the Associated Press that AI changes in the workplace are happening very quickly. So we need to all learn what are the best sources for staying current, he said. How can we update our skills? Who can be trusted sources? Gregory LeBlanc is a professor of finance, strategy, and law at the Hawes School of Business at Berkeley Law School in California. He says workers should be taught how to use and manage generative AI. LeBlanc said he thinks it makes more sense to center on teaching ways to support AI as opposed to learning to be really bad imitators of AI. He added that employees should be trained in areas where AI does not perform well so that workers can make up the difference. This year, at least four states proposed legislation that sought ways to deal with AI in the classroom. Those states included Connecticut, California, Mississippi, and Maryland. One bill in California would require a state working group to consider including AI literacy skills in math, science, history, and social science studies. The writer of the bill is California Assemblyman Mark Berman. He said in a statement that AI offers the possibility to improve parts of our lives, but only if we know how to use it and use it responsibly, he added. Berman noted that all students should be taught about basic AI elements and systems. He said students should also learn the skills to recognize when AI is employed. In Connecticut, Senator Maroney said his state's planned AI Academy will also aim to provide studies on AI basics. He noted the importance for people to have the skills to understand, examine, and effectively interact with a range of AI technologies. A study released by the job search company Indeed found that all U.S. jobs listed on the service had skills that could be performed or improved by generative AI tools. Nearly 20% of the Indeed job listings were considered highly exposed, This means the technology is considered good or excellent at 80% of the skills the jobs require. Nearly 46% of jobs on the service were moderately exposed. This means that AI tools can perform 50 to 80% of the skills. Moroni said he is concerned that AI will worsen existing equity problems related to a lack of high-speed internet, computers, and smartphones in some underserved communities. Inequalities have been identified between more digitally literate people, often living in cities, and those living in more rural areas without dependable internet and modern devices. Marvin Vinay shares that concern. He is with the Massachusetts-based group Bring Tech Home Advocates. The group has been working for years to narrow differences in computer literacy and high-speed internet availability. Vinay said, "Education must be included in order for this to really take off publicly, in a manner which is going to give people the ability to eliminate their barriers." Vinay added, "And it has to be able to explain to the most common individual why it is not only a useful tool, but why this tool will be something that can be trusted." I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn is here now to talk more about his technology report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for joining me.
Sure, glad to be here.
This week, you reported on programs in some states that aim to train workers on AI tools in an effort to make sure the workers can keep their jobs and work together with AI systems. Are these programs centered on any specific industries?
So my report was really more generally focused on what is now being described as generative AI tools, and these can really be used across many different industries. In the past, discussions about humans being replaced by machines centered mainly on manufacturing and robots doing certain jobs. With the new kinds of AI systems we're seeing, they are designed to perform many different duties, and they are being specifically created to do these jobs at near human levels. So this could include many daily jobs a lot of us currently do, such as writing or creating business presentations. And these kinds of skills are, of course, widely needed.
The report also included information on an interesting study about the big percentage of skills that can possibly be performed by AI tools. What are some of these?
So, for example, many of these are considered computer skills. And in this area alone, we could be talking about the ability to use certain software programs, such as Microsoft Word, to producing PowerPoint presentations, to creating graphics, to writing computer code. And experts say all of these job roles could, in theory, be partly or in some cases completely performed and pretty well by some of the AI tools that are already out there.
All right. Thanks so much for being here, Bryan. And thank you for your report.
You're welcome. Thank you.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Today's lesson helps you do more with Level 2 of our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Lesson 6 of Level 2 helps explain some ways we use prepositions in English. Let's listen to the beginning of the lesson. Anna has agreed to take her friend Penelope on a tour around the city.
Anna, thanks for taking me on a tour of D.C. today.
Sure thing, Penelope. You are new to town, and a tour is the best way to see more of the city.
So, which tour are we taking? The one that goes through the city on a bus, or the one that goes along the river in a boat?
Both.
Anna, this isn't going to be one of those trips, is it?
No. Follow me.
Okay. In this lesson, you are going to hear lots of prepositions. What's a preposition, you ask? It's a word that shows relationships between things. Anna says they are going on a tour through the city and along the river. Through and along are both prepositions. Watch for more.
It is often difficult for English learners to use prepositions correctly in all situations. That's because there are so many ways we can use them. Like Professor Bott says, we use prepositions to show physical relationships. But we also use them in many kinds of idiomatic expressions and phrasal verbs, and it's sometimes hard to know any rules for which preposition to use.
The good news is that mistakes with prepositions usually do not create problems for understanding what you want to communicate, unless, of course, you make a very basic mistake with a physical description.
Right, that's true. So, if you say, under the table, when you should say, on the table, that will, of course, create problems. That's a very basic beginning-level mistake.
But remember, we can learn from our mistakes, so keep on speaking English when you get the chance to. Lesson 6 uses prepositions mostly for physical descriptions. Let's listen to Anna and Penelope take a ride in a special vehicle, that is, a boat with wheels that takes tourists around the city to see famous places in Washington, D.C.
Well, Penelope, there's our ride!
What is it?
It's the famous D.C. Ducks, the boat with wheels. We will ride on the road and then sail on the water.
Who thinks of these things?
I don't know, but I'm glad they do. Let's get aboard, sailor.
Hey, did you know that this bus, boat, was created during World War II to carry people and supplies?
Wow. You know, a tour is so much more interesting with fun facts, like that one.
I agree. I love fun facts.
To get aboard means to get on a boat or a train. Now, here's more of their tour on the boat with wheels.
This is amazing, Anna. There are so many beautiful buildings along this road.
Hey, the Washington Monument is on the left.
Oh, look, Anna, we're across from the White House.
Penelope, the only thing between us and the president is the street, and a park, and a security gate, and police officers with guns.
Excuse me, do you want to know a fun fact about the White House?
Yes!
Inside the White House, there is a swimming pool, a movie theater, and 32 bathrooms.
32 bathrooms? That's a lot of bathrooms.
I'd be happy with 2. I live in a house with my mom, 4 sisters, 2 aunts, and only 1 bathroom.
Oh my.
You know, Anna, we should give him a tip.
Of course, it is polite to tip your tour guide. Luckily, I have lots of dollar bills.
That was a great fun fact. Here you go.
Thank you. I can tell you fun facts all day.
Did you hear any more prepositions of place? I heard between us and the president, inside the White House, and in a house.
Now let's look at a few examples to see how prepositions can have more than one meaning and how they can show more complex relationships.
Let's start with the preposition through. Anna and Penelope go on a tour through the city. That's a physical place. But we can also go through an experience or through a process that happens over a period of time. We can go through a change or through changes.
For example, teenagers go through a lot of changes between the ages of 13 and 18.
Yes, they sure do. Now, let's look at the preposition for. We can say we are going home for the holidays. This can mean a period of time during the holidays. Or it can mean the reason why we are doing something.
Right. Like I can say, I exercise for my health. That means I exercise to help my health.
We also use for to express a connection or relationship. We might say,
the students need to buy books for each subject they are studying.
In that example, the preposition for connects the phrase buy books with the words each subject.
Jill, what is your best advice for how students can learn to use prepositions correctly?
Because we use them so much and in so many different ways, I suggest learners pay careful attention and memorize the preposition that is used when they learn new expressions. For example, as we just explained, we can say the expression go through a process. A learner should memorize the whole expression.
And that way, the learner does not have to worry about how to choose or guess which preposition to use.
It does take a long time to learn the large number of expressions and their prepositions. So students need to be patient, and you need to practice using the expressions until you can say them naturally and easily. I also recommend reading a lot in English. Pick a book that is on a topic you like and read it for fun. The grammar of English will become more familiar to you the more you read.
Jill, before we go, we need to find out if the boat with wheels can also go in the water.
Well, to do that, we have to watch and listen to the next lesson, Lesson 7 of Level 2. That lesson gives many more examples of prepositions for physical places. We don't have time to listen to Lesson 7 in today's podcast, but here's one little part of it.
Penelope, this is amazing. A minute ago, we were riding along the river, and now we're riding in the river. Awesome!
So be sure to watch Lessons 6 and 7 to see all the places Anna and Penelope visit on the boat with wheels.
And you will also learn about a boy who makes money on their tour. The boy makes the money thanks to Anna and Penelope.
Well, we've made it through another lesson of the day. Thanks for listening to the Learning English Podcast.
Remember to share Let's Learn English with your family and friends. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.